Radio.
Hey, this is Dave Asprey with Bulletproof Radio. And today's cool fact of the day is that the flu virus can survive outside your body for about 48 hours normally, but on a piece of currency, it can last for up to 10 days. Today's guest is Dan Pena. Dan has been chairman of a lot of companies and a lot of industries, has raised billions of dollars in venture capital, and been a very successful business guy for multiple decades. He's also author of a book with a great title called Your First 100 Million, which is almost sounds over the top. And you also, Dan, run the Quantum Leap Advantage podcast.
Correct.
And if I had to think of words to describe you, over the top might be the right word. would you agree with that?
Eccentric, over the top, a little bit outrageous. Yeah, those all work.
Those all work. What's something about you that not a lot of people know?
Well, since we're filming here in Pasadena, even though I tell people, but not too many people are listening, I'm from about 10, 12 miles from here in East LA, from the Barrio. And when we came from the airport to driving here a few nights ago, and my driver, who I use when I'm here in Los Angeles, said, "Are we gonna go by the old place, boss?" And I said, and his name happens to be Dave. Dave, I said, no, my kids aren't with me, so we're not gonna make a spectacle, because whenever I come with my children and they know we turn left on the Bakersfield freeway coming just past Chavez Ravine to go left, they know we're gonna go by my old house. And of course, my kids are up to here. We're looking at my old house where I was raised as an adolescent. But not many people know that, and kind of nostalgic being this close to my old house. That's most people don't know that. The other thing that maybe perhaps most people don't realize, that I've been into, and we were just discussing it before we started filming, health and fitness for over 40 years. And they didn't call it biohacking then. They called it health, fitness, et cetera, fitness science, et cetera. But I got serious about my health about 1974. And in preparation for the first 50-mile marathon that I ran, and got more serious about it, the second 50-mile marathon that I ran. And I got even more serious about it when I ran my first 100, well, I only ran one 100-mile marathon. And the first time I ran 1,000 miles in a month. So I've been into health seriously for a long, long time. So it's been enjoyable to spend time with the kids here. And I call all your kids, because I'm old enough to be your father, if not your grandfather. And but when these kids talk about some of the things they've experienced, I said, yeah, I experienced that in 77. And they look at me like, 77, you know, it's almost like I said 1877. So it's been enjoyable, and but one thing that is really remarkable to me, and I hadn't really given it any thought, and I'll be 70 my next birthday, is that according to what I've listened to, I've been in the flow or in the zone almost all my life. Literally.
Does that explain your success?
I hadn't thought of it that way, but and that's why I'm grateful to you for having this, because the things that I have taken for granted, you know, in the late 60s, when I performed my first high performance act, I've always said I'm high on life. And for my age, that meant you were loaded, but I wasn't. I skipped drugs. But now I realize I have been high on life. I didn't understand how high I really was until I've listened to some of your great speakers about being in the flow and in the zone. And because I've done some pretty remarkable things that, looking back in hindsight, I just took them as a matter of fact. But as you well know, being a high performance guy yourself for a number of years, when you're used to setting the bar high, it becomes second nature to you. It just does. You do extraordinary things. And for the few kids, not few, maybe 60 or 50 or 60 kids that I've talked to since I've been here, when I tell them about, because most of them are the age of my children, that are 32, 31 boys, and I have a 28-year-old daughter. Wow. And I have set the bar for them very, very high. These kids say it must be tough being your child. And of course, my kids have been telling me this all their lives. And I see your kids, if those must be your kids running around.
Yep.
Yep. And I think it's your son in there taking notes. He's wearing glasses, right?
Oh, that's actually Joseph. He wrote an essay, he's 11, unsolicited, had the composure to write 2 pages asking to please come to the Bulletproof Conference. So I gave him a pass along with his parents. Oh. My son was the 5-year-old beating all the adults at the memory game.
Oh, that's okay. But I mean, it's remarkable that then the kids will, you know, I wish there was something like this when my kids were that small, for them to you know, get in the habit. So I've been in the flow, I've been in the zone, I've accomplished a lot of things. But the most remarkable thing, the last 21 years since I've been a high performance coach and Quantum Leap Advantage methodology I formulated when I started doing this in 1993, is that I've been able to create with guys and gals in the last 21 years over $50 billion in equity and value for them, not for me, for them. And I've gotten off on that more than my own claim to fame, which has taken $800 and turned it into $450 million in 8 years. Non-internet, bricks and mortar.
It's even harder.
I'm still looking for my first big internet hit. And I really get off on that because the knowledge that I've gained through my mentors, I've been able to translate and memorialize and pass on to, you know, tens of thousands of kids. And so there's some things that, you know, most people that unless they did some real research on my websites and or Wikipedia, which is only about 85% accurate. Which some people say that's pretty accurate for Wikipedia. I'm not one to point any fingers of indignation, but I think those are some things that are pretty remarkable that people may not know about me.
So you've had these multiple successes, yet you spend a ton of time sharing this knowledge. And Stephen Kotler, the guy who wrote Rise of Superman and the main first keynote here at the Bulletproof Conference.
Great deal.
Great guy. I'm assuming you got some time to spend with him.
Yeah.
Good. Just a gem of a guy. And one of the things that helps you enter the flow state is giving back and serving others. So I imagine that some of the flow state that you've experienced over the last 20 years, you're helping these entrepreneurs make billions of dollars. And it's
correct.
It keeps you focused and sharp. And
correct.
You don't strike me as a 70-year-old guy.
Well, I'll be 70 my next birthday. And so. I don't feel 70. I don't believe I look 70. Some people say I dress 70. But but this is me. This is how I dress. I'm not here to stand out amongst everybody else in their jeans and T-shirts. But this is how I dress. And some people would say that that's kind of like a Neanderthal. Maybe it is. But all I know is it works. But I dressed like this when I was 30. And it's worked for 40 years, or 39 years. But I do give back. I give back about a third of my time pro bono. And the other two-thirds, I manage my own assets and or look for opportunities. Early in my career, when I was a young guy like you, my pro bono was very minimal. And but as I've gotten older, and because I get so much enjoyment out of it, which I didn't think I do, in candor, and my wife is still surprised that I get off on it so much, helping the kids, that it's made my life very gratifying. But we travel a lot. From here, tomorrow we're on our way to Rome for 3 weeks in the Mediterranean, sailing around, and then I'll be up to the castle to meet your friend Brian Rose, who's going to come to the seminar. And people have asked me, surprisingly enough, are you going to treat him any differently than everybody else? And I don't know what he's told anybody, but I told him, if you come, I'm going to treat you like everybody else.
So what do you do at your conferences?
Okay. We have 15 people, roughly. They're 8 days. The opening night is a business dinner attire where we all sit and get to, like an icebreaker, so to speak. The next morning, it starts at 7 o'clock with breakfast, and you go 8 days. It's basically from 7 in the morning till roughly 6:30 at night, the whole day. We break for an hour for lunch. We have 2 15-minute breaks during the day. The last night is a graduation night where it's equivalent of black ties and kilts. Everybody wears kilts and tuxedo, where we hand out awards and graduation certificates, etc. But we basically take them very much like the military. We tear them down the first 2 or 3 days to their, some people say their bones, some people say their souls. And then we build them up with the characteristics of the high performance people that I've been privileged to be around, because I've been around a lot of people. And there's 75% of the high performance people that I've been privileged to be around all do things about the same, 75%. The last 25% makes everybody different. Steve Jobs was different than Warren Buffett, that 25%. And notwithstanding, Steve never, and I happen to have known Steve, God rest his soul, he didn't go to college, or 3 weeks at Oregon State or Oregon, whatever school he went to. Some guys went to Harvard, some guys went to Wharton, you know, some guys have multiple degrees, some guys have no degrees. And we go through the characteristics of what has made these people happy. It's not all about money, but if, it's like I told Brian a few months ago, if your mother gets sick and your daughter wants to go to Wharton and pay the money, my daughter just graduated from Northwestern Graduate School, nice, and want to pay the big money, it takes money. If you want to support various orphanages, as my wife and I do, that takes money, not Zen.
Yep.
And so that's what we teach them. But we've had people lose 100 pounds, 150 pounds. Some people say that QLA is better for losing weight. By the way, I know you lost 100 pounds, correct?
Yep.
I lost 70.
Congratulations.
Okay. I used to be a big weight lifter. And when I turned 60, 9 years ago, I tore both rotator cuffs, both sides. I tore my long head bicep. I have an artificial shoulder, titanium shoulder. I have a steel hip. My body started to, because I was lifting too heavy.
Yeah.
Now, in hindsight, it seems very clear to me. At the time, I said, no, I can still push myself. Well, anyway, that's a whole other story. That's my type A personality. But the decided to stop lifting heavy weights, go back to medium weights or light weights, and I lost about 25 pounds of fat and about 50 pounds of muscle.
Yeah.
Because I was like this.
Wow.
I was a big guy, 280. I weigh now 210.
Even at 60, you were 280.
I was 280. So. And when I used to walk through the airport, people used to think that I was a sumo wrestler. I mean, I was a big guy. I was a big guy. And that only on a 6'1" frame. If I was as tall as you, I probably could have carried 280 a little better. So I decided to get more healthy. So the last 7 or 8 years, and I've kept the 70 pounds off, and just as you've kept your weight off. And I've been a proponent of healthy living, and because the high performance executives that I know are in good shape. There's the odd, with the greatest respect, Mr. Buffett's not such in great shape. Okay. Yeah. Okay. His partner, Charlie Munger, who's 90 something, is not in such good shape. But those guys aside, most of the high performance guys that I know are in pretty good damn shape. They are.
Is that just a part of being high performance, is taking care of your hardware?
Yes, I believe so. We didn't call it that.
Yeah.
Okay. Your generation calls it that. We just, we all die trying to live longer. I didn't understand that until about 8 or 9 years ago. And that's why I admire these kids. They're getting started early. I mean, they have no idea what a benefit this is going to be for them 20, 30 years from now. Now, when I talk to some of the kids about 20, 30 years from now, their eyes roll back in their head, 20, 30, you know, we're worried about next month, 20, 30 yeah. years from now. But, Dave's stuff, you know, works, you know, and not just because he lost 100 pounds and is healthy, but all these people in the audience wouldn't be here if it didn't work.
Yeah, they've all done a lot of it in order to just take 3 days out of their life to be here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The thing that actually touches me the most is, you know, Joseph, that 11-year-old kid who, in his essay, I wear my blue blocker glasses at night when I'm doing my homework.
That's great.
I'm eating healthy stuff. I pay more attention in class. If you get this right when you're 11 or when you're 20, I didn't get any of this really till I was, you know, my mid-20s. I started realizing there's some serious problems here, but I didn't get the stuff dialed in really till I was about 30, and I'm 41 now. And the amount of damage that I incurred, and just the amount of stress and pain and the screw in my knee after 3 surgeries, all that stuff was unnecessary. And so the money and time that went into just reversing the crap instead of just not having it in the first place. So the younger someone started, it's such a gift when they do it. And the trick for me, and one of the things I work on Bulletproof, is how do you show people who aren't sick and aren't old the value of being young and healthy?
The benefits.
Because you don't value them until you lose them.
Yeah.
Right?
I've had my knees operated on 3 times. I've had my elbows operated on 3 times. I already told you about some of the artificial parts that I have. But if I had been smarter in my 20s and 30s, yeah, and even 40s, I wouldn't have had, because most of all these operations had happened to me in my 50s and 60s. I wore out the parts when they didn't have to be worn out. I hadn't thought about this until I was reading some stuff on you about the money that you called biohack.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I've spent over $1 million on me.
Good for you.
Yeah, and I went back and I did some calculations, and then I didn't tell my wife. but I had no idea, because I was going to La Clinique Prairie in Switzerland and Johns Hopkins and Scripps in San Diego and those kind of places since the middle 70s, because I was interested in keeping myself as healthy. And I must admit, when I that period of 6 or 8 years that I lifted big heavy weights, I lost focus about staying lean. Yeah. And because I thought I was trying to get up to 300 pounds. I couldn't make it. 280 and 3/4 pounds is the heaviest I could get. And when I tell people that, they look at me like, "Have you lost your mind? Have you lost your mind, Dan?" But it was a good thing at the right time. At that time, I thought it was a great idea. It's like I was listening to the Zen guy this afternoon.
Dave Kelstein?
Yeah. He was just now. But the guy...
Bill Harris.
No, the guy this morning. The Indian fellow. Was he Indian?
This morning.
Meditation guy.
Oh, Pedram.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Pedram Sholje from well.org, the Taoist monk. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I've never meditated. But when we got up, and he says, bend your knees like this, tuck your butt in, okay? Now, and I talked to a number of people. I've done this before. I could see through my third eye, okay?
Just naturally, you can
naturally
do that.
Okay. I could feel like he was talking about.
Yeah.
The people next to me couldn't feel anything, okay? And then when it was over, I was still standing like that. And the young colleague that I'm here with, Chris, and they said, "Is he all right?" Me, am I all right? But I could feel it, and I have, that ability. And whereas I praise the people that do meditate, but I haven't had to do that because I have the ability. I can get within myself in about 60 seconds. I've never had any trouble sleeping. And I'm ashamed to say, when I was your age, I used to tell people, "I give stress. I don't get stress. I give heart attacks. You say a lot of dumb things when you're young kids. I'm a classic example of that. And now I realize, because I fall asleep in between 90 and 180 seconds every night, no matter if the ceiling has just caved in on me.
You got me beat. It takes me 3 minutes every night.
Okay.
But up to 3 minutes. But. All right, you're the first guy I know who can do it faster. That's amazing.
And okay. I don't worry, and I know I can just imagine having done conferences like this. It rained this morning. I fell for you. I felt, I said, oh, why did it have to rain on Dave's parade this morning? And I said, because I've been there. I've shown up in auditoriums as big as that with two people in the audience.
You know, they all showed up. We had
That's great.
People.
That's great. I'm glad the sun came out.
Yeah.
If it was still, you know, heaving down rain, you know, I'm sure you would have lost some people.
I was doing some biohacking last night to end the drought. So I was...
That's great.
Not really. Yeah. But it's interesting. So you've always had a natural sort of spiritual or connectedness to your body, so some intuition or some senses.
Correct.
That maybe most people don't know that they have or just don't have.
Correct. I don't do the model anymore because it was too hard on people, but I used to give my seminars for free in the 90s. I used to fill up the Biltmore Hotel in Los Angeles. I used to give them at the LAX. I used to get free PBS advertising, and I'd put 800, 1,000 people for free. I used to give the seminars. And we tracked the results. The results were okay by industry standards, but were mediocre. Because if the people didn't pay, have a pay price to action, nobody followed up.
It's true. I've known many people who retired after very successful careers, and they volunteer for free, and no one will listen to them. They charge $100 an hour, and they're experts, and everyone will listen. There's something about an exchange there, and some of the most impressive spiritual teachers I know charge, and they do it for that reason, even if they don't need the money, because when you make a decision to overcome even a small hurdle, a $20 hurdle or a $20,000 hurdle, it makes you commit. And if you're not committed to a change process,
correct,
you don't do it.
I agree 100%. What gets measured gets accomplished. And the message for the few people that I've talked to one-on-one or in little groups is that we all fear is false expectations appearing real, and we all fear accountability no matter what we say. We all fear accountability, and it's the differentiation between the super high performance individual and everybody else. My most successful corporate mentee is Klaus Kleinfeld. He's currently the CEO and chairman of Alcoa. He was the CEO of Siemens AG, the 20th largest company in the world. In the late 90s, he came to me as a middle manager. He was 39 years old, and he said, I'd like to be on the corporate executive board of Siemens, which they run it by corporate executive board, then a supervisory board. And I said to him, I said, Dr. Kleinfeld, I think we're going to make sure that your goal is now to be CEO. 6 years later, when he was appointed CEO of Siemens, I was the first person he called. Because most of us, because we were afraid of failure, set our benchmarks low, our expectations low. When you lost, I don't know if you were trying to lose 100 pounds.
I was, desperately, yeah.
Okay, well, you committed. And one of the guys that I read his book just because I skimmed his book fast, quickly, the Spartan Up guy.
Yeah.
And he said, you commit yourself. I committed myself to 70 pounds. Now, I should have committed myself to 80 pounds, but I didn't. I committed myself to only 70 pounds because I figured out that 210, which was my high school football weight, was the weight that I should weigh. Mm-hmm. But when you commit yourself, and you've done a great job, and I'm sure that the next conference will even be better. And congratulations on your and good fortune to you on your restaurant that you just opened up.
Thank you.
And I look forward to eating there when it does open next time I'm back in Los Angeles. But I'm sure it'll be a success. But you opened it up in the right area,
Santa Monica.
Believe me. I mean, the West Side is if anybody's going to eat Bulletproof. That's the place.
It's amazing. My goal with the restaurant is to just show people how good they can feel, because that becomes their new bar. And then they'll make that commitment to doing other things that make them feel good most of the time. Because my experience is that a lot of people, a lot of the time, feel crappy, and they've become used to it, that they don't know it. So if we can shock them out of it a little bit, then they'll feel good. But my goal is, 100 million people helped. I don't mean they have to go to my restaurant. That's going to require a lot of restaurants. But I mean that they'll get the knowledge, and they'll do things that reduce their incidence of disease. But more importantly, will turn their brain on all the way so they can do whatever the heck they want to do. You talked about something kind of interesting. At your seminars, you tear people down and build them back up.
Correct.
And all of the good personal growth things I've taken, that I've done, the most impactful ones, take at least 7 days, oftentimes 10 days. And the first 3 days are basically about breaking through defenses so you can actually see what's going on and then do the work. What do you do to tear people down?
Okay. We have two bank accounts in life. We have an emotional bank account and a financial bank account. Most people worry about the financial bank account, but it's the emotional bank account, getting out of your comfort zone, et cetera, that really dictates what your financial bank account is. We tear down the conventional wisdom, and I believe political correctness is almost always wrong. Even though our parents loved us, at least my parents and most of the parents I know, yours might be different, were in no position to train a high-performance kid to be a high-performance, okay?
Yeah.
Unless your parents were both Olympians, it's not likely that you're going to be an Olympian, okay? And I love this story about the doctor who, when he was 10 years old, who was the Olympic, he went to the Olympics in 1972. So we tear through a lot of those, as many of those barriers. Before you come to the seminar, you fill out a very lengthy questionnaire, detailed questionnaire. So really, I know more about your life and your business, for your business for sure, than you do. And I ask questions, hard questions, that you haven't really thought about or you've put back someplace you don't want to think about. So when the seminar starts, and I go through this in copious information, and so I restructure the last 20 or 25% of the 1,500 PowerPoint slides that we go through to the individual audience. So I know Dave's got this issue. I know she's got this issue. And when husband and wife teams come, you have no idea. I talk to them separately, and the husband says, she loves coming to work with me every day. She loves doing our books. She loves this. I talked to her, she says, I hate it. I'm gonna blow my brains out. He doesn't know. I said, well, why don't you tell him? He said, I can't. You understand. So we go through those issues, normally we teach them how to realign their goals to bodacious goals. You know, when I'm not a proponent of Mr. Obama's politics, but one thing I do agree with, he set bodacious goal to be the first black president. Those are the kind of, you know, 10x, we want 10 times whatever you were thinking. When I took $800 and turned it into $450 million, the goal, I fell $1.5 billion short. The goal was $2 billion, but nobody's feeling sorry for me, okay?
Yeah.
And so we tear those down, and we don't want realistic goals. We want them to be very unrealistic. And then the real key to the program and the reason why we've had so much darn success is I coach them for free, mentor them for a year afterwards for free. For free. You know, they pay for the seminar, they show the commitment, and even though I don't think 10,000 pounds is so expensive, most people do, okay, for a week. Although you're a 40 years of Zen guy,
yep.
similar price
yeah.
point, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But to go to that thing, you're committed.
Yeah.
Okay?
It's
and
true.
And so, but now for the next year, I mentor them for nothing. We have weekly reports. And since the mentor program is for free, if you don't say, you don't do what you said you were gonna do, I throw you out, okay? So every week, after 3 or 4 weeks, I look at your report and I said, Dave, you said this, you said this, you said this, but you only did 2, not 1, 3, and 5. I'll give you a couple opportunities. We've all got excuses, okay? But if you continue that pattern, well, then it's just one less person I have to deal with. And we have monthly conference calls, either on Zoom calls, so everybody can see everybody's face on the call. So when Dave is making excuses, you can see, read it in the faces, and then the other kids will jump in and say, hey, Dave, last month you said so-and-so. That's bullshit, Dave. And it works very well. And by the end of the 12 months, I mean, these guys are really, you know, emotionally Navy SEALs, okay? We're not making them physically Navy SEALs,
mm-hmm.
but emotionally they're Navy SEALs. And as I said, 2 bank accounts, emotional bank account, financial bank account, and they're tough kids. Another one of my favorite stories is I had a kid who came to me flinging pizzas.
Wow.
26 years old, and I was staying at the Beverly Wilshire, and he comes up, and a friend of mine said, can you meet this pizza kid? Okay. He came in, he said, I want to be Steven Spielberg. Okay. I'd like all his Academy Awards, but okay. I said, I told him, be a limo driver. You'll meet actors, da-da-da-da-da-da. Last November, his premiere show movie that he produced and directed was just aired in New York City 6 years later. From pizza boy to limo driver to movie maker.
Wow. I got a question for you. When I was 16, I read Napoleon Hill, a big Napoleon Hill fan, wrote down what I wanted to do. And I said, I want to be a millionaire by the time I'm 23. I made $6 million when I was 26. And I lost it when I was 28.
That's unfortunately pretty normal, unfortunately, yeah.
What's up with that?
It is because, well, a couple things. Number one, you had already fulfilled your expectation. Okay, so you might have let down. In fact, yeah. I'm positive you let down.
Yeah.
Okay, you let down. You lose focus. Okay, yep. A kid with that much money.
Yep.
Okay. I don't know you well enough, but you could have engaged in self-sabotaging activities.
Most definitely.
Okay, yeah. And maybe I didn't really deserve it. I didn't pay my dues.
I had some of that too.
Okay,
yeah.
I tell the kids, when the people tell you when you're young, you've got plenty of time, that's baloney. That's BS. You don't have plenty of time. Pretty soon you wake up and you'll be 41.
Yeah.
Okay. And pretty soon you wake up and you'll be 69 like I am. And so, but that happens all the time. We have, we've got half a dozen guys that have created billions. We got a couple that have lost billions.
Yeah.
I'm not proud of it, but I'm probably the only high performance coach around that has personally lost $300 or $400 million myself. Okay, fortunately, I made more than that, but it's I can't speak for everybody. You get full of yourself, and you have a lot of people, and with the greatest respect, you have a lot of people telling you how smart you are here.
It's all the speakers who are smart.
I'm
a collector of ideas, and I test some stuff.
Yeah, but if people are, it's like when Caesar was coming through the Colosseum, and his driver is yelling at Caesar, glory is fleeting. Okay, we don't have people to ground us. We don't have people, and I went through this, in the last 20 years I haven't gone through it, but in the first 20, 25 years that I was very successful, I mean, just imagine if in my 30s, I turned $60,000 into $100 million in 90 days. Okay,
wow.
I did a bunch of really magical things. I didn't think they were magical at the time because I was in the flow.
Yeah.
I was in the zone. Yeah. And I was the first person to pay myself a bunch of money as a CEO of a public company in the London Stock Exchange. And guys like Murdoch and all these guys are calling me up and say, thanks, Dan, you broke the ceiling. Now we can pay ourselves whatever we want. And when you hang, you show me your friends and I'll show you your future. The kids that I talked to today didn't like hearing that. You're the average of the five people you hang around with most. They didn't like hearing that either. Because they're not hanging around with you. That's why it's tough for you to get some free time. Because they realize, on a subconscious level, that, God, if I spent more time with Dave, I'm gonna be like Dave. They're right.
Yep.
But you can't spread yourself 400, 500, 600 people. You can't do that.
Haven't figured out how yet.
Well, when you do, let me know.
Exactly.
Yeah. So that's what we do, and we've got it's the mentor program. That's the key, because I had three great mentors. One was Konstantin Gratzos, the CEO of Onassis Shipping Lines, who is the 60-year friend of Aristotle Onassis. I had Jim Newman, who wrote Release Your Brakes, which was, and I had a guy named Jerry Ormond, who was a oil guy. And those three guys from my early 30s until they passed away were the guys that, structured my lateral thinking. Because when you stay focused, you can get a lot accomplished. A lot of the other parts of your life fall to crap, but if you stay focused. And I got asked at least 25 times since I've been here, is there such a thing as a balanced life? And I now use a quote by Jack Welch, a guy that I know, former CEO of General Electric, arguably the greatest CEO in the last 50 years. He says, there's life choices and they all have consequences. So you play with that the way you want. There's life choices and they all have consequences. we didn't get to do this podcast because you wanted to be a father the other night, and I took my hat off to you, remember? Okay. I wasn't that good a father. Okay. And if my three kids were sitting right there, they'd say, that's right, Dad. Okay. But I admired that. Okay. And we're here now. And now I'm glad it turned out, as my mother would say, dearly departed. You know, everything works out for the best.
Yeah.
So I wound up coming here.
Thank you.
Okay. And so it worked out. But the consequence was I have a studio. My film crew was sitting there, and I said, we're not doing it. We're not shooting tonight. But as it turned out, we did another.
We did. And I apologize.
No problem. I only bring it up because life has choices and there's consequences.
Yeah. And when my kids made the commitment to fly down, which is a big one when you're 5 and 7, there was only a little window for them. And you know, my responsibilities as a dad are more important than even a fantastic interview like this.
No, well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. There's a question that I've asked every guest who's been on the show, and I'm really curious what your answers are going to be, because I doubt that they'll be ones I've heard before. The question is, given all of your accomplishments, all the things you've learned about life, including your flow state, but whatever comes to you, the three most important pieces of advice you'd have for people who want to perform better at whatever they do, that doesn't have to be in business or in sports, just perform better as human beings.
So only one. Just fucking do it. Don't analyze, don't spreadsheet. In the old days, they used to say, Lotus 1, 2, 3. Do the kids still remember what that means?
Yeah, I do. But.
Okay, just do it. And if there was a sub one, a second one, is focus on the few. Another question that I'm often asked, what's the best advice that you never took that you should have? Okay, and it's focus on the few, not the many. And Costa Gratzos told me that when I was, a long, long time ago. Again, God rest his soul. And I thought that he's wrong. I can do 15, 20 things at a time. He was wrong. He was right and I was wrong. So just do it. Don't analyze. Follow your heart and focus on the few, not the many. And you'll be successful. The money will follow. If you're doing something that you're passionate about and you love, the money will follow. And the accolades and the success and the emotional fulfillment will follow. And there's a lot of kids that are not just kids, but a lot of people at the seminar are doing, they've got 6 businesses, 10 businesses, 20 businesses, and I the long term of me being in business almost 50 years tells me that the chances of there being a high performance across that spectrum is pretty slim.
So focus on the few businesses, few opportunities, few people.
Yeah, the few. Okay. And it's very important, as Oprah Winfrey says, who you bring on your bus, okay? And you want people to be on your bus that it doesn't matter how many times you pivot the business idea, that they're gonna play an integral part to your future. And but the key is, for everybody that's gonna watch this and the people that I've talked to at the seminar, find a mentor, Now, you're not gonna be mentored to 600 people, I understand that.
Yeah.
Although I'm sure you could line them up here. But
sure.
Yeah, find a mentor that's where you wanna be someday. He or she personifies what you wanna be, whether it's in health, science, whatever the idea is. And you'll have a great career and we'll read about you.
Dan, thanks a lot for being on the show.
It's my pleasure.
Can you tell people where to find out more about your learning academy, Quantum Learning Academy?
DanPena.com or AskThe50BillionDollarMan.com.
I love that URL.
Yeah. And when you turn it on, it's got the Rocky theme, which I actually pay residuals for. I'm one of the few guys on the internet actually pays residuals. If you have questions, if you have questions, you can email me or the site, or you can actually phone in. We have a toll-free number. And we're giving away a free Castle seminar to the best question after this seminar in October. So you could actually win a Castle seminar. And we've got some great questions, but we're gonna do that. This is the first time we've tried it, and we've got a lot of questions, a lot of smart people out there. Remember, kids, show me your friends and I show you your future.
For years, I've experimented with whey protein. There are so many different types of whey protein on the market that I gave up on them. I noticed that I was getting inflamed when I would use whey protein, and I was getting highly unpredictable results. After a while, I decided that I would, as a real biohacker would, go out and solve the problem once and for all. See the head of foam that's formed on it? This is similar to what you get with a latte. There are actually little bubbles still coming to the surface, just like a freshly steamed latte, but the flavor is something that you wouldn't expect. It is creamier and more delicious than a latte ever has a chance of being, not to mention it has metabolic effects, like it helps you lose weight and it makes you feel amazing focus for hours and hours.